I'm Julie Phillip from WXXI. Thank you for joining us for this Voice of the Voter debate. Voice of the Voter is a media collaboration between WXXI, the Democrat and Chronicle, 13 WHAM TV, and WDKX. We have with us today Mark Johns, who is a Republican, conservative, and independence candidate for New York State Assembly in the 135th District. His opponent, Democrat David Koon, declined our invitation to debate, to participate in a Voice of the Voter debate, saying he had scheduling conflicts. Thank you for joining us today.
Thanks, Mr. Julie. Johns. Appreciate being here.
And we are going to go ahead and conduct this as a casual debate. We will not time your answers. We'll ask you the same questions we would have had both candidates been here. And you'll be given the opportunity to present both an opening and a closing statement. So why don't we start with that?
Well, for people that don't know me, I'm Assemblyman Mark Johns, and I'm in my first term in Albany. In the first 2 years, first of all, let me just say it's 135th Assembly District. I represent Webster, Penfield, Perrington, and East Rochester. And in the first 2 years, we've had two on-time state budgets. Working together with the governor and both parties, we cut $13 billion in wasteful spending. We've got the lowest middle-class tax rate in 58 years. I voted to restore the EPIC program, so it's the senior prescription program for the elderly. We've done a number of good things in Albany in the last 2 years, but I feel as though more remains to be done.
Okay. And with me on the panel is Jessica Alimo, who is a political reporter for the Democrat and Chronicle, and she will ask the first question.
Thank you, Julie. I was hoping you could start off by elaborating on your first 2 years in Albany, and as a member of the minority party, what have you been able to accomplish?
That's a great question, because I found out that as a member of the minority party, you have much more power and much more independence. And that's something that I don't think the average voter understands. When you're in the majority, you're expected to vote yes on all the issues that come to the floor. You vote for Sheldon Silver to be the speaker every January. And every bill that comes to the floor miraculously passes. And that's not necessarily good government. But when you're in the minority, our leader down there, Brian Kolb, tells us, I don't care which way you vote on any particular issue. This be able to explain your vote. So you have much more freedom, much more power to advocate for ideas. And if you have a good idea in the minority party, the majority party will take that idea. They'll come to you or and ask you to be the sponsor of that bill, and then you co-sponsor the bill, so the legislation will wind up getting passed. Or they will decide to make up a bill that looks almost identical to yours and pass it anyway. So as the governor says, the best ideas in the state come from the minority parties.
Could you give some specific examples of when you've crossed over and given an idea or worked with the majority to pass something that was important to you?
A good example is the 2% property tax cap. Now, my predecessor and others before I was there couldn't even pass a 4% property tax cap. The 2% property tax cap came out of the Republican minority, but it was picked up by the governor, and the governor said, we want to pass this, and guess what? Both parties passed it. Now, before I got there, they couldn't pass a 4% property tax cap. All of a sudden, we had 18% new members. And of course, I'm for term limits and a lot of other things that career politicians are not necessarily for. But knowing that there were so many new members in 2010, it sent a message to the rest of the legislators down in Albany that the people back home were sick of what was going on. They were sick of late budgets, budgets coming in 1, 2, 3, 4 months late. And of course, in the minority, people complained about it. But with larger minorities and with new members, not only in the Republican side, but in the Democrat side, so many new members sent a message to the new governor and to the incumbents that had won re-election last time. It said, look, we want things done differently. We want on-time budgets. And we did that, 2 in a row. When was the last time you can remember 2 budgets in a row? We had budgets that were going up for the previous 15 years. They were going up at 2 or 3 times the rate of inflation. The 2 years that I was in there, we cut $13 billion in wasteful spending. That's a huge difference from what had previously gone on. 2% property tax cap, restoring the EPIC program. We restored the sales tax exclusion on clothes and shoes under $110. So, you know, we've done a lot of things, and a lot of these ideas originate with the minority parties. And they're brought forward. Now, a lot of times the majority party will co-opt those bills on their own, which is fine, because if no one needs to take credit. The new governor has been very good about saying that we can get a lot done if no party needs to take credit for it. And I agree with him.
As a follow-up, could you talk to us about the SOLE Act, what your role was in the SOLE Act, and what you believe its impact was if it were to ever come to fruition?
Well, I'm going to be pushing that bill again in January. SOLE, it goes by a lot of different acronyms, but this means that every legislator, Democrat, Republican, majority or minority party, whether you're in the Senate side or the Assembly side, you will have an opportunity to bring one bill forward to the floor for an up or down vote, a discussion, a debate, and an up or down vote. And you get that one piece of legislation if you choose. You don't have to do it, but if you choose to bring a piece of legislation up, you get one shot every 2 years to bring something forward. Now, what I would like to see is, you know, term limits, but there could be all kinds of good bills that could be brought forward, and they won't be obstructed in the committees. Albany notoriously has bills come to the committee, if they even do come to the committee, and then they're set aside for future consideration, which means they're killed, they're dead. And I think with all the bills that we vote on, this is what a lot of people back in the district or in New York don't really know. Every 2 years in Albany, in the state legislature, the state assembly, they author upwards of 12,000 bills, 12,000 pieces of legislation. At the most, we vote on 1,000 every year. And most of the time, in a two-year cycle, we're voting on about 800 of those bills year after year after year, and they go nowhere. And we vote on some important legislation, and we vote on, you know, quite literally some nonsense. But if we could bring some meaningful bills forward, why don't we vote on them? And I think the people back home would like to see members, obviously the minority parties would certainly bring bills forward. But there's so much discipline in the majority party that you're not going to get out of line. You know, we vote on 1,000 bills a year, let's say. You know how many of them fail? None. Every bill that comes to the floor in the state assembly passes. I mean, if you flipped a coin 1,000 times, you'd assume that it's not always going to be heads, but it doesn't make any difference. The debate, the discussion, it rarely makes any difference. And only about 20%, 10 to 20% of the bills are even controversial. There's not a lot of debate on most of the bills, but even when there is, it doesn't make any difference. There's always going to be at least 76 votes there to pass the bill in the state assembly. And that party discipline is not what the people back home really want.
Rumor has it that after the election, the state legislature will be looking for a pay raise. I want to know how you feel about that.
Yeah, that's the least well-kept secret down there. The Democrat majority has been talking openly and in private about going back and giving themselves a huge pay raise. And of course, I'll be voting against any pay raise. I don't think we need more reasons to keep career politicians down in Albany. They do very well. And by the way, if they get pay raises, their pensions are going to wind up going up. I co-sponsored a bill to take the politicians out of the pension system. And to go down there and give yourself, you get a base pay of about $80,000 a year, to go down there and give you a $30,000 or $40,000 pay raise, if it's such a good idea, why don't they vote on it or vote on it before the election, or why don't they put it in their campaign pieces? You know, send it out in the literature to the people of the 135th district. You know, if you elect this Democratic assemblyman, he's going to go back and give himself a big pay raise. I don't think that's a winning proposition, and I'll be voting against it.
Let's shift and talk about Medicaid. It's also no secret that Medicaid puts a considerable strain on the state budget. What changes do you support and I think are necessary in the coming years?
Well, what we've started to institute, MRT, the Medicaid Redesign Team, we've done a few things in this state. There's a supercomputer system called Verify New York. It was done by IBM. But what they're doing now is they're starting to look at billing records because of, they say 5 to 10% of the billing in Medicaid could be fraud. And, you know, when they found a dentist last year in New York City filling 1,000 teeth a week, you know, I mean, that's just not possible. And this type of overbilling, a lot of the hospital stays and, you know, I mean, ambulance rides, all kinds of things. We need to work on that. We also need to encourage our federal legislators to up the amount that New York State gets back. When Medicaid came into existence back in the 60s, we only got 50% reimbursement from the federal government. And the reason why that was is because the federal government said, well, New York had the highest incomes in the country. So some states are reimbursed 60, 70, 75%. New York State doesn't get that. That's something that we need to insist that our federal legislators start working on. Because if you had equality across the board, even if we got another 10%, that would be $5 billion a year. That coupled with cutting down on the waste, fraud, and abuse that they're starting to do, streamlining the system. The governor has a panel that was instituted this year, and hopefully we're going to redesign that Medicaid system even more thoroughly next year.
We keep hearing from Albany and the administration that New York is now open for business. A lot of business people don't feel that that's anything more than words for the most part. What's your opinion on how open we've become in the past year or two, and what do you think needs to be done in the coming year or two?
Well, believe me when I tell you, in the last couple of years, obviously we as a nation are hurting for jobs. We've lost good paying, especially good paying manufacturing jobs. But I promoted and voted for legislation that would help, especially manufacturing businesses, low-cost energy, low-cost electricity. And we've encouraged people in this state to expand manufacturing. And we've done that already. And in this area, in the Rochester metro area, we've created more jobs in the last 2 years. Now, things aren't great, but we've created more jobs in this area than anywhere else in New York State. We are also doing it with the governor has the economic development councils. There's 10 of them around the state. We brought in, and when I say we, I'm talking about the governor and both parties, both sides of the legislature, brought in $69 million in economic development aid to this area. And more is going to be coming in at the end of the year. But it's important to realize that we've done this in a bipartisan way. It used to be in the past they had pork barrel member items, just absolute wasteful spending. You don't see that anymore. The governor doesn't allow it, and I agree with him. What we do now is we put it into lump sums where no one is going to get the credit. We all get the credit. And when we get rid of partisan politics and we all start working together as a team, we can say New York State is open for business.
What responsibility does the state have to address issues of urban poverty, and what specific issues do you feel need to be addressed?
Well, I think a lot of times people go to college and come out with unbelievable debt. So I would be for scholarships, for training programs, for two-year programs like MCC has, applied technology. Do you know if you come out with a two-year degree from, let's say, a college like MCC in the what we call the STEM area, science, technology, engineering, and math, if you have a degree in that area, you can wind up getting a job in high-tech manufacturing. And in this state, in this country, if we don't have manufacturing jobs, we're not going to create wealth, and we're not going to have good-paying jobs going into the future. So a lot of the kids, a lot of the young people that are coming out of high school can have promising careers. They don't need four-year degrees. They don't need master's degrees. They need to have competency in an area of science, math, and technology. We're falling down on that. But as we train young people, we can actually start bringing those jobs back to this state, not only from other states, but from around the world. We're starting to do it. Nanotechnology, you see it in Albany, you see it in this area. Photonics, we actually need people. They say that there's upwards of 50,000 job shortage for high-tech workers, mid-level workers. We should be encouraging that, and we should be encouraging that right at the high school level. Building trades, skilled trades, manufacturing trades, very important for the future of this country. We can't all work in the service sector, and if we did, guess what? Those jobs are traditionally low paying, so you're not going to do very well in the long run.
You know, that answer talked about eliminating poverty in the future, but currently there are so many children in across New York State who are living in poverty, and that number is growing not just in the cities but in the suburbs of Rochester. That number is growing according to statistics. What would you do to make sure that the basic economic needs of children in our community are met every day now?
Well, I agree that the public assistance programs like Medicaid, aid to families with dependent children, we should make sure that that is kept in place even when people find a job. There's a lot of women who are working, they're single moms for whatever reason. There's no reason why we should punish the working poor. We should be helping them. And I agree that social service should not be cut off when someone gets a job or even as they wind up moving up in the ranks. There's no reason why someone should have their benefit, Medicaid or insurance, rent subsidies, that shouldn't be pulled from them, food stamps or other things, just because they're working. We should have something along the lines of workfare where we're actually helping the working poor. Why do we want to punish people that are actually out there working as hard as anybody else? That poor woman that's making $20,000 a year is working just as hard as the guy making $100,000. We shouldn't say that because she's down on her luck, we're going to pull the rug from under her or her family. And I think by being more generous to the people that are trying to help themselves, in the long run, getting rid of the bureaucracy and the social service bureaucracy and helping people is going to help them and the future generations. Poverty seems to be systemic, one generation after another.
Thank you.
Sticking on the issue with poverty, what suggestions would you make for our education system to help those children in poverty?
Well, as I said, I think we need to have some type of scholarship program. We need to hold it out there. Let the parents know, let the kids know, especially as they get into middle school and high school. We are going to have job training out there for you, and it's going to be free. We're going to give you a scholarship. If you're willing to go to school for math and science, and you're willing to get a two-year technical degree, or you're willing to get into the building trades or other things like that, where we need people. It's not something that, you know, where they say, well, you ought to go there. We actually need people that can work in those areas. And we need to encourage that and say, look, we're going to give you scholarships in order to be able to do it. And guess what? You're going to get a good paying job when you get out. And unlike a lot of people that go to four-year degrees or have a master's degree, you're coming out of school now with an average of $30,000 in debt and no discernible job skills. But if you bring people out of school, and maybe it's a trade school after high school, or maybe it's something with the BOCES program or something with MCC, guess what? You can wind up having these young people with real job skills that can make a real living and won't be needing social services, have a promising future.
I want to talk about the property tax cap. I know we touched a little bit on Medicaid as an expensive mandate for local municipalities, but the property tax cap on municipalities and school districts is proving to be a real challenge because it was supposed to come with mandate relief to make that 2% cap doable. And municipalities and school districts are saying the mandate relief just isn't happening nearly fast enough to help us meet that cap. What would you do in the coming year to address this problem?
Well, you're absolutely right. And the big discussion in Albany about the tax cap was, are we going to do mandate relief along with it? Or are we going to put the tax cap on and then that will force us to do mandate relief? And we're going to have to. When we get back in January, we're going to have to. I've met with the school boards in my office, in Albany, in Fairport, and I've also gone to meetings where, with school superintendents and others, and they're worried about it. And it's not just the school districts, the city, the counties, the state itself. One of the number one mandates that's going up is the cost of pensions. We had a tier six down there, which, to be honest, I guess was a little bit of reform, but it doesn't really take effect or do any good for about 20 years. We need to put a cap on the pensions. That was never brought up. I stood up on the floor and said, why don't we cap the pensions at a reasonable amount instead of allowing the number one pensioner in New York State? You know, a school superintendent from Long Island left employment 2 years ago. He's making $312,000 a year in a pension. That's outrageous. We need to cap the pension. So no matter what you're making, you're only going to get so much. And actually, the unions are agreeable to that, but it never came up in Tier 6. So I voted against Tier 6 because it wasn't real reform. I mean, it was somewhat a modicum of reform, but it's not really going to kick in for 20 years. And my thought is this, you know, if you want to cut the pensions 20%, and they're going to be 20% less 20, 30 years from now, well, that's fine. But what about that poor woman that's making $30,000 a year in a pension? Maybe she's put in 35, 40 years in a job. You're going to cut her pension from $30,000 to $24,000? But yet that guy that's making $100,000 a year in a pension, if they cut his pension 20%, he's still making $80,000. We need to cap it at the top. It does two things. It allows the people that are getting a pension to know that pension's going to be secure going forward. We've seen so many pensions. You see it at Kodak and other places, Eastern Airlines when they went bankrupt, other private sector companies throw their pensions to the PBGC, which is Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation down in Washington, which, by the way, is out of money. But they would limit how much you could get in a pension to $52,000 a year. They would cap it. And no one wants to have, when it was back, I remember a few years ago when Eastern Airlines and some of the airlines went out of business, some of the pilots that were getting $88,000 a year got their pensions cut in half to $44,000. And that's basically what they do. They cut your pension in half and they cap it. Now, we don't want to have that type of financial disaster going forward. You know, you can't blame it on the comptroller. We need to blame this on a legislature that can't see that there's a problem coming down the line. The pension costs in this country are going to be overwhelming. And a lot of people that are getting a pension cannot afford to have their pensions cut in half. You know, these fat cats that are making $200,000 a year in a pension, you cut them to $100,000, they're doing just fine. But if somebody's making $30,000 or $40,000 and you cut that pension in half in order to make the system solvent, that's a big problem.
Okay, can I just clarify? So in order to give municipalities and school districts some mandate relief, capping pensions is one of your solutions? Are there others?
Well, that's the biggest one. I mean, obviously, okay. Medicaid is number one, and pensions are number two, and that's what everybody talks about. At the county level, at the state level, you know, the state pays in. And Tier 6, I commend the governor for trying to come up with a solution, but it really wasn't. Tier 6, as you know, is the sixth evolution of the pension system. I mean, Tier 2 took care of Tier 1, Tier 3 and 4 took care of theirs. Tier 5, 3 years ago when they instituted Tier 5, it said it's not going to work. We're going to have to come back. And I wasn't even there, but I told the legislators, one of the principles I ran on 2 years ago, I said, this isn't going to work. And golly, look what happened. And now, in 2 or 3 years, we're going to be talking about Tier 7. Let's solve the problem. 90% of the pensioners get less than $60,000 a year. Okay? Now, that's $5,000 a month for being retired. 90% are getting less than $60,000. If you capped it at $60,000, you'd save a half $1 billion a year. That's real money. And that's money that the municipalities, the towns, the villages, the school districts don't have to pay in. It also makes sure that the pension system, which in New York State, the pension system is worth about $150 billion. Well, if you save it a half $1 billion a year, that's real money. That's money that doesn't come out and money that doesn't have to be paid in.
Okay, thank you.
Sticking with the issue of public employment, others have suggested that we need to make some reforms in terms of how our public employees are compensated. Do you suggest any reforms, such as the Triborough Amendment?
Well, the Taylor Laws and the Triborough Amendment are misunderstood by a lot of people. The Taylor Laws, basically, you don't want to repeal them because that says government employees can't go out on strike. The last thing you want is people in the front line going out on strike. You don't want that. We need public health inspectors, firefighters, police. You don't want them to go out on strike. But they also, because they can't go out on strike, have contracts that are put in place. You know, Monroe County, this to give you an example. Monroe County workers have not had a pay raise in 4 years, okay? Maggie Brooks has held the line on that. Now, I know that they're not happy about it, but they have not had a pay raise in 4 years. Now I hear they're going to get a $250 bonus and a 2% raise in January. 2% after 5 years? Now, they've held the line. It's up to the people on the school boards, the school superintendents, the town supervisors, the governor. The governor has done a good job. The governor negotiated with every union in the state. They're getting 3 years of no raises, and then two followed up by two successive years of 2% apiece. If they had done the Monroe County standard, no raises for 4 years, you know what that would be? That would be almost $2 billion extra the state would have right now. So when they make foolish decisions and then blame it on Triborough Amendment or blame it on Taylor laws, those laws are just saying that basically the contract you have stays in place. If you're at the top of your bracket in a contract, guess what? You can go 2, 3, 4 years and not get a raise. You know, to blame it on the people at the bottom, it's the people at the top that are making the decision. And they can sit there and hold back as long as they want to. And you know what? When you go 2, 3, 4 years without a raise, you're going to become much more negotiable.
Okay, we have time for one more question, and then it will move to closing statement. Sure. The Tax Foundation recently placed New York dead last when it comes to being open for business, business friendly, and they largely attributed that to New York's very complex tax system and high tax rates.
Right.
What do you think about that, and do you have ideas for simplifying New York's tax system and making it more affordable for people and businesses?
Well, certainly. I mean, as far as income tax goes, we have done a little bit to allay the taxes that a manufacturing business pays. We've given them tax breaks. You know, business doesn't actually pay taxes. People do. So if the New York legislators want to tax higher income people, fine. If you're making a good living and you're here in New York State, you're not going anywhere. But you can't tax businesses because they can move. There are constantly, as the governor said, there are constantly businesses that are leaving New York. They're going to South Carolina. They're going to North Carolina. They're going to Texas. We have to be competitive with these other states. And if you have a good paying job or any kind of job, you're not going to move. But businesses can get up and move, manufacturing businesses especially. There's no reason that they have to stay in New York. We have a lot of advantages. We have a pool of fresh water in these Great Lakes that's larger than any pool of fresh water in the entire world. We have a lot of students that are smart. They do well in school, high tech, and we, combined with the fresh water system we have to the north of us, can do a lot to invite business here. But we can't tax them to the point that they say, you know what? They add everything up. They say, yep, good workforce, educated workforce, plenty of fresh water in the Great Lakes. But if New York State has a reputation as tax hell, the governor said there's no place for New York State if we're number one in taxes. So we need to get off businesses, especially manufacturing, who can move anywhere, and invite them to New York. New business that comes in, big tax break. Businesses that are already here, if they want to expand, let's give them a big tax break.
Okay. With that, we're going to give you the last word to deliver your closing statement and discuss whatever you would like.
Well, I would like to tell people that the closing statement is going to be short, but would you please, you know, go to markjohns.org. That's my website, markjohns.org. And I'd appreciate, you know, sharing that with your friends. I just want to let people know that I am for term limits. And unlike my opponent, I'm not going to flip-flop on that. He was there for 15 years. Now I hear him on TV say he wants to go back and institute term limits. You know, before I left Albany, there was a gentleman that told me, he goes, Mark, I've been for term limits for 30 years. Really? You know, it's never come up for a vote. That's why the SOLE Act is very important, because it is a single opportunity for legislative equality. We do all kinds of things in Albany, and we demand equality. let's let every legislature bring a legislator bring a bill to the floor for an up or down vote. Then you'll see discussions on term limits, campaign finance reform, independent redistricting. They fiddled and diddled in the state assembly for almost a year, coming up with designer districts to protect the incumbents. Guess what? They couldn't come up with the districts for the congressional because we went from 29 to 27 congressional districts. They argued and fought in New York City, couldn't come up with anything. A federal judge came in and she divided up the 27 congressional districts fair and impartially, and she did it in 1 week. So we need to reform the system, and that's what I'm about, and that's my promise to you. If you elect me, I will go down there in January and you will see a bill for term limits. You will see a bill for campaign finance reform. You will see that I deliver and we deliver a bill for independent redistricting, because if you don't reform the system, you're going to get pay to play back in Albany. And that's where the problem is. $200 million a year goes to lobby Albany, folks. How many people are listening to this show today? How many people are out there that are going to be voting? What do you think you can do to stand up to that kind of money? When Sheldon Silver has tens of millions of dollars that he can funnel out to the people that are going to vote for him in January, and he can give them $500,000 to run their campaign, is it any wonder that every January they go back to Albany and vote for him to be the leader? And then he decides what's going to go to the floor for an up or down vote? No wonder why the majority party has no power. At least with an independent person like myself, I can go down there and talk about what's wrong, why it's wrong, and how to fix it. I'm on the Republican line, the conservative line, and most important for you independent thinkers out there, I'm on the Independence Party line. And when I make a promise that I think no one should be down there for more than 8 or 10 years, I'm going to keep my promise. I won't be flip-flopping it. And I hope that you tell your friends about WXXI's website so they can go and look at this tape. And hopefully go and check out my website, markjohns.org. And thank you, Julie and Jessica, for allowing me to come in here today and take this time.
Thank you. That was not that short.
Thank you.
Mark Johns, he is running for New York State Assembly in the 135th District on the Republican, Conservative, and Independence lines. His opponent, Democrat David Koon, declined our invitation to participate in today's Voice of the Voter debate. Voice of the Voter, again, a media collaboration between WXXI, The Democrat and Chronicle, 13 WHAM TV, and WDKX-FM. It is supported in part by the Community Foundation. I'm Julie Phillip from WXXI. Thank you very much.